Good morning. Welcome to AEI. I'm Rick Hess, Director of Education Policy Studies here at AEI. Delighted you all can join us early this morning for today's event, Education Reform in the 114th Congress, a conversation with Representative John Kline, Chairman of the House Committee on Education and the Workforce. Those of you in this audience are people who spend a little bit of time following issues educational. Therefore, you're well aware that the Republicans had a big night back in November, which gave them their largest majority in the U.S. House, going back more than half a century, and also shifted the U.S. Senate into Republican control. Chairman Kline, back in 2013, chaired the committee that has passed the only effort to reauthorize No Child Left Behind through one or the other House of Congress. It was H.R. 5, the Student Success Act. In the last couple of months since November's elections, and particularly in the last few weeks, there is a lot of attention to the likelihood that No Child Left Behind might finally be reauthorized 14 years after it was initially passed, 6 or 7 years after it was supposed to be reauthorized. There is also discussion around a couple of other questions educational. The president has floated an idea to make community college free across the land. You might have heard him talk about this a little bit the other night in the State of the Union. And there has been much discussion about the federal role in supporting early childhood education. When we are having conversations like this, it is easy for us to spend a lot of time talking to each other. Most of us have little or no impact on the determinations that our elected officials actually make. As somebody who has little or no impact, I feel confident saying that. But one of the public services we try to provide at AEI is an opportunity to speak with the individuals who really are making the decisions that matter, who really are trying to drive the process so that we can make democratic decisions about how do we improve and enhance the kinds of policies we're making around education. In that spirit, I am honored and delighted to welcome the chairman of the House Committee on Education and the Workforce today. Folks in this room don't need much introduction to Chairman Kline, but especially for those who may be joining us across the country via live stream, let me just say a couple words about the chairman. He has served in Congress since 2002. He has been chairman of the House Committee on Education and Workforce since 2010. He represents the 2nd District in Minnesota. Before entering Congress, Mr. Kline served in the United States Marine Corps for 25 years. Attaining the rank of colonel. He served as a helicopter pilot and earned the responsibility of flying Marine One, the president's personal helicopter. He also served as a personal military aide to Presidents Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan. In the course of those duties, he was the man charged with carrying the nuclear football, a briefcase the contents of which can be used by the president to authorize a nuclear attack while away from fixed command centers. Mr. Kline is a man who has dealt with a little bit of pressure over the years. I don't think he's particularly cowed by the challenges of higher ed and K-12. And I think that is a healthy and good thing. Please turn off cell phones as I welcome up the chairman. The hashtag for this event, for those folks following via Twitter, is Kline at AEI. The full video will be available on AEI's website tomorrow. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to invite you to take the mic. Thank you.
That easy, go from Rick to John Kline. Yeah, I'm not cowed often by pressure until I stand up here and look out at this audience. So now I'm starting to sense what pressure is. It's a room full of experts. I'm gonna move this if I can. Thanks, Rick, for the introduction. It's pretty much like we wrote it. I always appreciate that. I want to thank, somebody's got to write it. I want to thank AEI for hosting this morning and, frankly, for your leadership, because you do make a difference. I appreciated your humility, but the fact is you and people in this room do make a difference, and I'm very appreciative of that. In fact, I would say thanks to the staff, leaders, supporters of AEI, the hope for a better future actually burns brightly. It is that hope that makes it possible to press on even when we have so many challenges and the years slip by and we get further behind and the challenges persist. You pointed out that last fall, the American people sent what I thought was a pretty clear message. They want to move the country in a new direction. They want to get things done. They want to move us in a direction that leads to prosperity and opportunity. And it's, if you think about opportunity for a minute, that's really what America's about. That's how we got started. I mean, people in European countries hundreds of years ago went down and got on creaky wooden little ships and they sailed over here and then they headed across the plains and canyons and deserts. They were looking for opportunity and they found it and they can find it again. Even today, it's no small task finding that opportunity when you look at the problems that face us. As I meet with people from Minnesota and across the country, they often share their concerns and frustrations. They are concerned about the future and frustrated with a federal government that just doesn't get it. But we're Americans, so I also sense that sense of optimism. Despite our challenges, we still live in the greatest nation on earth. There is nothing we can't accomplish once we set our minds to it. The same country that won the race to the moon and invented the iPhone, I do question that invention sometimes. It can continue to lead the world and remain a shining city on the hill, but to do so will require a lot of hard work, some tough choices, the courage to fight for our principles, and what is a really tough one, the willingness to accept compromise. Hard thing to find these days. More than 50 years ago, President Kennedy looked to the future with confidence and a healthy dose of realism. He knew we couldn't achieve peace and prosperity within 100 days, or 1,000 days, or even during his administration. But President Kennedy rallied a nation with three simple words: let us begin. I believe that is our charge today. Let us begin building a stronger economy and a better America. Let us begin that great effort for the moms and dads living paycheck to paycheck and wondering how they will send their kids to college and plan for retirement. Let us begin for the entrepreneurs and small business owners struggling to succeed under a cloud of uncertainty and a mountain of red tape. Let us begin for the millions of Americans who are being left behind because they can't find full-time jobs. Let us begin for each and every child filled with hopes and dreams, trapped in failing schools. For the next few minutes, I'd like to discuss how the Education and Workforce Committee will play a role, a leading role, in that effort, and more specifically, what the committee plans to do to improve education for America's children. At an event hosted by AEI 3 years ago, I spoke about the failure of U.S. schools to teach our children what they need to know to thrive in the 21st century economy. I described the state of the American education system as, quote, sobering. As I look back, those words describe the situation rather mildly. I wish I could say things have started to turn around, but they have not. It's estimated that one out of every five students will drop out of high school, which means every day thousands of children walk away from one of the best shots they have to earn success in their lifetimes. These young men and women will face fewer job prospects, lower wages, and be more dependent on government assistance to help pay the bills and put food on the table. But don't get me wrong, just because a student receives a diploma doesn't mean he or she is guaranteed success. Far too many high school graduates are entering the workforce with a subpar education. According to the National Assessment for Educational Progress, only 38% of high school seniors can read at grade level, and just 26% are proficient at math. I mean, 75% couldn't even understand what I just said. I mean, that's pretty bad. Each year, countless parents have no choice but to send their kids to broken schools. Meanwhile, Washington talks about reform, yet nothing changes. Something has to change. I know you're familiar with No Child Left Behind. Rick mentioned it, signed by President Bush 13 years ago. Enacting the law was the last time federal lawmakers reformed our K-12 education system. Despite its best intentions, and I think the intentions were fine, who wants to leave a child behind? The law is failing to meet the needs of students. For example, a one-size-fits-all federal accountability system hampers innovation and limits the ability of states and school districts to address their students' needs. Outdated teacher quality measures fail to adequately capture how well teachers teach, and a massive investment of taxpayer resources has done little, if anything, to change the trajectory of student achievement levels. Instead of working with Congress to replace the law, the administration has spent the last several years offering states temporary waivers from the law's most onerous requirements if states agree to new mandates dictated by the Secretary of Education. Congress wanted to provide relief, yet the administration said, you can have relief, but only with strings attached. Now states and schools are tied up in knots. Allowing the Secretary of Education to act like the nation's superintendent only creates confusion, uncertainty, and frustration. Another example is the ongoing debate around Common Core. What began as a voluntary effort at the state level to improve education standards has led to a broader revolt against federal overreach into our classrooms. I support a state's right to determine what its education standards will be, and I understand how important parental involvement is in determining how these standards are met. The Department of Education doesn't have a role in this process. Secretary Duncan doesn't have a role in this process, nor do any of his predecessors or successors. Success in school should be determined by those who teach inside our classrooms, by state and local leaders who understand the challenges facing their communities, by parents who know better than anybody the needs of their children. Unfortunately, we've reached the point where too many decisions are made in Washington. While there are heroic efforts taking place in classrooms across the country, the federal government has more control over schools than ever before. It is making it difficult for educators to provide a quality education, and countless children are paying the price. We need to do better. We have a moral obligation to do better. That is why more than a year ago, the Republican-led House, back to the results of the election, we passed a bill, the Student Success Act. The Student Success Act would have restored the balance between the federal government's limited role and the responsibilities of states and local governments to deliver an excellent education to all students. The bill moved away from one-size-fits-all accountability requirements and eliminated, for example, the onerous, quote, highly qualified teacher requirement that tells us nothing, actually, about teacher effectiveness. The legislation also consolidated dozens of ineffective and duplicative education programs. I think the number is something like 69. I mean, just that number just drives me crazy. There are over 80 federal K-12 programs. I don't know why we didn't consolidate all 80, but 69 was a pretty good step. And the bill gave, when it did that, we created something called the Local Academic Flexible Grant. In many meetings in Minnesota and around the country and talking to some of you in this room, and it's nice to see some old friends in the room hiding around in the tables here, particularly when I was talking to the administrators, superintendents, and principals, they said, I need flexibility. This is crazy. I have money over here, and I actually don't need it. I'm desperate for money here, and I can't move it over. I can't spend it. It's crippling me. I need flexibility. That was one of the major aims of that legislation, and I was very pleased to see that we were able to give that flexibility that these leaders need in order to do their jobs. The Student Success Act was the first comprehensive bill reauthorizing the Elementary and Secondary Education Act to be considered in Congress in more than 11 years. It was an important step to replace a flawed law, but unfortunately, it was the last step taken in the 113th Congress to do this. Our colleagues in the Senate under Leader Reid refused to consider the bill or any legislation addressing K-12 education. Forcing schools to continue wrestling with a convoluted waiver scheme and a broken law. Fortunately, we got some new allies in the Senate who share our sense of urgency. Chairman Lamar Alexander has already begun the reauthorization process in the Senate, and I look forward to partnering with him. He and I both agree that Congress needs to act because the status quo is failing our students. The stakes are too high to let this opportunity slip by. It's time to reform the law so every child can receive the quality education they deserve. Replacing No Child Left Behind would be a significant achievement for any Congress, but we actually need to do more. There are other windows of opportunity to improve education we must pursue. As you know in this room, the Perkins Act provides federal funding to states to support career and technical education, CTE programs. The law helps high school and community college students access valuable training programs. Or as my friend Virginia Fox always says, no, they're not training programs, they're education programs. Okay. We need those programs and the hands-on experience necessary to gain an edge in the local workforce. The best CTE programs are known for their rigorous coursework and hands-on training in fields ranging from computer science and information technology to law enforcement and nursing. And I've just got to add welding. It's just crazy how many places I've gone around the country, and when I'm just talking to schools, or more importantly, when I'm talking to employers in all kinds of industries, if you're a welder, you got a job. It's amazing. It's amazing, and it makes me wish I had paid a lot more attention in eighth grade shop. It's unbelievable. Or a skilled truck driver. The jobs are there. People need the skills, CTE training, or educating would help. But the law needs to be reformed. We need to do a better job connecting coursework with industry demands and local labor market needs. We also need to help students as they leave high school and prepare to enroll in a college or university. Finally, we need to enhance accountability to help ensure taxpayer dollars are well spent. A number of my committee colleagues are passionate about this issue and eager to get to work improving the law. And last but not least, we need to strengthen higher education so more Americans can turn the dream of an advanced degree into reality. A college degree is a good investment, yet for many the cost is simply too great. Others struggle to fit their traditional college experience into an already hectic lifestyle that may include family, work, or both. What can we do to help address these challenges? First, we have to empower students and families to make informed decisions. Students and families should have access to the best information that is easy to understand, not volumes of stuff that they won't even begin to look at. Second, we need to simplify and improve student aid. Let's pull students and families out of the current maze of programs and help students receive a clearer picture of their financial aid in a more timely manner. Third, we need to promote innovation, access, and completion. Innovation is the key to giving families more affordable choices in higher education. We also need to strengthen programs that encourage access and help ensure every student who enrolls in an institution completes their education. Fourth and finally, we must provide strong accountability and preserve a limited federal role. We need to ensure taxpayer dollars are well spent, but also be mindful that federal rules and reporting requirements add administrative costs on schools, costs that are typically passed on to students in the form of higher fees and tuition. And ladies and gentlemen, the reporting requirements are already huge. We had a hearing a few years ago, and I've talked to staff so many times, I was so impressed. Maybe I'm just easily impressed, I'm not sure. But one of the witnesses came in and sat at the witness table, and he had a big pile of three-ring binders. And I was fascinated by that pile of three-ring binders. And he got to his testimony, and he said, these are rules, these are reports. But these are really not the rules and regulations. These are the table of contents to the rules and regulations. That's unacceptable. That's crazy. That's what they're dealing with. So we need to simplify this. Is there a lot of work to do? Absolutely. But I'm optimistic about our chances. The House of Representatives is ready to hit the ground running. We heard loud and clear the message sent by the American people, and we're ready to do the work that is necessary to move our country in a new direction. We can't do it alone. Success will require presidential leadership, the kind of leadership, frankly, we haven't seen in recent years. We need constructive engagement from the administration. Drawing lines in the sand isn't constructive. Responding critically in the press to each new development in the legislative process isn't constructive. Proposing ideas more fit for a political campaign than reality isn't constructive either. If we're going to succeed, the administration will need to start working with us and not against us. And we'll need the help of stakeholders, people in this room. Perhaps that's why I'm so optimistic about our chances. By educating the public and cultivating responsible reforms, AEI and other concerned stakeholders are making a difference. I'm grateful for all that you do. Look forward to working with you. Together, let us begin building a stronger America. Thank you.
Okay.
Where do you want?
All righty. Okay. Okay. So, Mr. Chairman, you just mentioned that this is a room full of stakeholders, and stakeholders have a lot of practical questions. First question many of them are probably wondering is, so what's the timeline in the House as you tackle reauthorization of NNCLB?
The time is now. As most people in this room know, I have been trying to replace No Child Left Behind for 4 years as the chairman. We've moved legislation in the 112th and the 113th Congress. The 113th Congress was the Student Success Act. So we have the basics in place. We are ready to go. My expectation is we will have a bill through committee and through the floor of the House before the end of March. I am hopeful, frankly, that we will be able to get floor time as early as the end of February. So it is time to get going.
Should we anticipate hearings for the committee, or have you guys done that recently enough that you can move?
I think the latter. We've obviously had a lot of hearings, a lot of discussions. It is time to get something to the president's desk. And if I can expand on that a little bit, we've got our legislation well teed up. We will have an open markup session in committee. The amendments can be offered. We'll take it through a committee. We'll take it to the floor. We will pass it. What's really important now is that we have partners in the Senate. As I mentioned in my remarks, Senator Alexander is already working on legislation there. He has considering it's the Senate, it's a kind of ambitious schedule, but I think he's going to get there. I tease him all the time about the pace of their operation and whether they're actually doing work. But they are now, and they're going to get it done. And so we are not co-authoring. We're not trying to write the same bill. We're going to pass a bill. They'll pass a bill in the Senate, and I actually think that we haven't seen this much in Washington lately, but I think that we'll then go to conference and be able to produce a piece of legislation that we can get to the president's desk before the end of the year.
But you would anticipate that the House floor, the floor vote on that bill would likely be before the end of March?
Oh, yes. Yes, absolutely. I'll be very disappointed if it's not. And again, I'm not the majority leader. I don't control the floor time, but I talk to him. And I'm led to believe in those conversations that we'll have floor time. We'll be able to get it done.
And, you know, many folks in this room know that Speaker Boehner, obviously, was one of the, you know, one of the key players in the passage of the original No Child Left Behind. Mm-hmm. Folks sometimes wonder whether he's comfortable with Student Success Act, which envisions several changes to that bill. Is this something that you have discussed with the Speaker?
Well, he voted for the Student Success Act. And kind of made a point of it, in fact. He understands, I mean, he was trying to do what the name of the law says, and this leave no child behind. And as you remember, President Bush was passionate about this. He wanted this desperately. Well, they ended up with a law, as sometimes happens. It has some flaws. In fact, some very, very serious flaws. Even before, after I was elected, before I was sworn in, I was being told, this isn't going to work. You got to do something about this. Every child, we're going to, if we have to have every child at grade level by 2014 in reading math, well, every school is going to be failing. Turns out that was right. And so it, we've known that it's had a problem from the beginning, and Speaker Boehner knows that. So he knows that, we need to change the law.
And will the Student Success Act then be the blueprint for what you're going to take into committee markup?
Yeah, that's a starting point. That's legislation that's already passed, been debated, and we're going to open it up again. It'll be debated some more, but it's a good starting point. People should, if you want to look and see where we're starting, just look at the Student Success Act from the last Congress, and that'll be pretty close to what we bring forward.
You know, obviously one of the questions that got less attention as you were discussing and passing the Student Success Act than it is today is this whole question of testing, or whether to retain the NCLB 3-8 testing framework in reading and math, whether to move towards something more like the grade span testing that President Clinton had proposed back 20 years ago in 1994. Curious where you're at on that and where you think legislation might move towards that in the House.
In the Student Success Act, we retained that annual testing as it was in No Child Left Behind. You're right, there's a lot more discussion about it now, but one of the things that I always thought was important, one of the good things, if you will, out of No Child Left Behind, was the ability to gather meaningful data, which you got from testing, and then to take it apart and be able to look at it in a disaggregated way. I'm always trying to find something, some way to not say disaggregated, but I haven't quite figured it out yet. It's just built into the lexicon. But let you get in there and see if you are systematically leaving some students behind. We don't want that. So I understand there is a lot of attention. There are proposals, as you said, grade span testing, every other year testing, some ways to reduce the level of testing. And there may be amendments offered, and I'm sure that debate will continue as we go forward. I just think it's important that we keep enough meaningful data that we can make sure we're not leaving kids behind, segments behind. And what that looks like, I'm not sure how it'll come out. But right now, I'm afraid of moving away from the annual testing too far, because then you don't have the useful data. So that's where we're starting. And by the way, clearly a lot of the pushback on testing has come from the fact that there are, get to be pretty draconian consequences if you're not doing well in that testing. And by taking away that federal footprint there, the AYP will go away and the federal mandates, I think it will relieve some of the angst that is associated with testing.
And what should folks anticipate as far as a blueprint when it comes to charter schooling, when it comes to school choice, portability of Title I? What are y'all looking at?
Well, charter schools is public school choice. I'm a big fan and proponent. There are just too many examples of kids who have been in failing traditional public schools, trapped, no way to get out, and charter schools, maybe Jeffrey Canada in Harlem or something like that, come along with Promise Academies and Success Academies, and suddenly there's hope. In fact, I visited a charter school in North Minneapolis. Luke Messer went with me from Indiana. It was a fascinating visit. School, about 430 kids. Kids are engaged, and they're active, and they're excited. And I talked to the parents. We had a round table, about as many people as these two tables, and they were excited about the chances for their son or daughter. And they tell these just heart-wrenching stories about, well, my son, he was failing, and it just was no hope. And now look at him. He's excited, and he's engaged. And so those kind of testimonials tell you a lot. But then I was talking to the founder, and I said, well, could you grow? Well, no, we don't want to get any bigger. I think the number is 430, but around 400 kids. This is the size that works. We'd like to replicate. We'd like another one because we have a waiting list of 1,000 kids. 1,000. And that story can be told around the country. It's a way out. So I'm a proponent of it. I have tried. We passed charter school legislation to allow good charter schools to replicate and expand easier. We passed it in the 112th Congress, and then I did it in the 113th Congress because I pulled it out of the Student Success Act and brought it up for a vote. These are huge, 360 votes. It's very strong bipartisan support. So what you will see is the charter schools are now put back in. I take it out, put it in, take it. It's back in the Student Success Act as we try to move comprehensive legislation to replace No Child Left Behind. But it's an important part of the public school system, and it's the best opportunity for choice. I think parents ought to have as much choice as possible. This is the choice that has strong support, and what I expect will come through. I think it'll go all the way through the process.
And how about conversations about Title I portability, the ability of Title I students to take some of those dollars to even private schools?
Well, I'm a proponent of choice. Our former majority leader, Eric Cantor, wanted to do that to allow the money to follow the student, including to private schools, and simply couldn't pass it. Their votes weren't in the House. So my expectation is that you will have some portability within the public school system. I don't think the votes are there to allow the portability into private schools, and to have vouchers, in other words. So I'm looking for what can get done, and my expectation, I think the language that has passed in the Student Success Act allowed some portability in the public school system, but not in the private school.
You alluded to Secretary Duncan's waivers earlier. Last week, in a speech laying out some, laying out some markers on reauthorization, yeah, he suggested it would be a retreat from the principles of No Child Left Behind to do away with AYP, to do away entirely with federal mandates around school improvement. That it would simply be leaving vulnerable children to the whims of local districts or states that might not step up. Curious how you think about that challenge.
Well, I think that this the largest intrusion of the federal government into K-12 education was No Child Left Behind. My argument is that it was flawed. It is not working, and the secretary's conditional temporary waiver system is also causing all kinds of problems. I had a lengthy conversation with Secretary Duncan when he started to do that. And my conversation started by saying, if you do this, A, I don't think the law allows you to do it. I still think that's true, but we're doing it anyway. I said, you will take all the wind out of the sails of reauthorizing ESEA, because everybody will divert their attention to trying to get one of these waivers. Well, they did it anyway. And so we're in the intolerable position now of the Secretary of Education writing education policy, implementing education policy for the country. And I just think that's unacceptable. So what's happened as states put their attention to getting a waiver, understandable because all their schools were going to be failing in 2014 under No Child Left Behind, so they went to get the waivers. And then they discovered, and I've had a lot of discussions, Minnesota has a waiver. They discovered that, well, wait a minute, these waivers are temporary and they're conditional. I don't get the waiver if I don't do what Secretary Duncan wants me to do. Well, they don't like either aspect of that. And the temporary part is really causing them trouble now as they try to get another year, or maybe they're trying to get a 3-year, and he's talked about a 5-year, but it's temporary. And so the wind is getting back in the sails of changing the law. And that's what we have to have. But now the pressure is starting to come back up, saying, let's get out of this waiver business and change the law.
And as you think about those changes, Wade Henderson, obviously yesterday in the Senate hearings, made the argument that if the federal government backs too far off of AYP, backs too far off of mandates around school improvement, that it's going to leave vulnerable children at risk. Curious how
I don't think that's the case. You need some kind of a report card, and that's back to this testing and information and being able to look to see how schools are doing. Parents need to know, and they've got to have good information. And then you can compare states with NAEP, but you need some information. You need a report card, but you don't need the federal government deciding what you need to do to fix your school. And so, and Lamar Alexander and I have talked about this at some length, and he is adamant about leaving these decisions to the states. And we do that in the Student Success Act. And I don't think that you'll see an abandonment of caring for kids as long as you have this report card, so people can see what's going on.
And one last question, and let's open it up. The president on Tuesday night talked about his Free Community College initiative, proposing substantial tax increases in order to make community college free. Curious your reaction to that. He's out on the stump this week talking about it. How do you feel about the plan? Is that something that you could see passing the House?
No. No.
Okay.
No, look how you started. Tax increases to pay for it. You know, you had $350, $360, $370, $380 billion in tax increases. He knows there's not a chance in the world that will pass. And then you have this suggestion, and it's another new program. Like, we're short on programs, another new program that we don't have the money for. And before we take up any new program, let's look at the programs that we already have. I used to have this conversation with George Miller. We actually had really good conversations. But he had a proposal one time to start a green schools program. And I said, well, why do you want to do that when it'll be another new, chronically underfunded program? Why do you want to do that? Well, because we have some places where the schools are terrible and we need new schools. I said, well, some places do have some terrible schools. But every school district in America would be better served if the federal government would meet its commitment to fund special ed. The deal from the 1970s was that the federal government would provide 40% of the increased cost that came with IDEA. We've never gotten half that. So let's look at commitments we already have and stop inventing a populist new program. And there's some interesting twists about this. I mean, there's a system so that middle-class parents can save to send their kids to college. But in his proposals, as I understand it, he would actually tax those so that people could go free. It's not well thought out. It's clearly a populist thing. Everybody likes free. But no, we're not going to go there. We have other commitments. Let's examine those and before we come up with some new idea.
Okay, let's go ahead and open it up to questions. We've got about 10 minutes. I'd ask that folks please be kind enough to identify yourself by name and affiliation, and please actually ask a question. If we get about 15 seconds in and I don't see the question coming, we'll give somebody else a chance. Sarah?
Good morning, Congressman. Thank you. I admire your tie.
My wife picked it out.
The plat is in.
Go ahead and identify.
We have talked a lot. Oh, I'm Jerry Schroff with the American Educational Research Association. And I don't want to discourage other conversations about the bill that's now on your mind. But there are other education legislation bills that are also waiting for authorization from the Congress. One of particular interest to us, of course, is the one about the IES reauthorization. But I'm wondering, how do you see the rest of this train unfolding now that once you get passed and introduce your bill and pass it in the House? Thank you.
Excellent question. We have to keep multiple balls in the air. So we are moving out with a focus on getting ESEA through, but almost in tandem, right behind it, we're also working on reauthorizing the Higher Education Act, another big, major piece of legislation. And as you point out, there are things like the Old Americans Act, there's child nutrition, there are things that we are going to be working on. And I know that's not what this audience is here for, but this is the Education and Workforce Committee. And so we have a lot of stuff going on the workforce, on the labor side, and we have to do all of those things. But the two big pieces, ESEA and higher ed, are working very, one right behind the other. And there's a lot of work in both. We've done a lot of work on the Student Success Act and ESEA, so we're ready to bring that forward. But there's still an awful lot of work that has to go, because by the time the Senate does its work, and then you get to conference, there's still a lot of work to be done there while we're doing higher ed, while we're doing older Americans, while we're doing child nutrition, all of those things.
And on the Higher Ed Act, is it your expectation that you would be able to get a bill to the floor and off the floor this coming calendar year?
I hope so. It comes as no news or surprise to people in this room that 2016 is a presidential election year. And once you get into that year, it gets really hard. The whole narrative changes. Your candidates for each party or multiple candidates for parties, the narrative starts to change. So I'm anxious to move fairly quickly. We held 14 hearings at subcommittee and full committee level last Congress on higher ed. So we're not starting from scratch there. We're ready to start rolling, and we're going to be moving pretty quickly. The time frame for ESEA, for the Student Success Act, is short enough that I can pretty confidently predict where we are. As you start to move further out, then it gets much more complicated, because the Senate activity has to be figured out, the floor time. So that's a long answer to your question. I'm trying to wiggle out of it. I can't tell you, but I would like to get it done.
And on the narrower question, the Education Sciences Research Act that Jerry alluded to, you and the Senate came pretty close to getting a final bill done last time.
We should get that done.
Okay. Elizabeth?
Good morning. Andrew Morse with the National Association for Student Personnel Administrators. And I would just like to ask a question about the likelihood of compromise regarding affordability issues in higher education, particularly for low and middle income Americans?
I'm not sure I know how to answer that question. A compromise on affordability issues, because that's pretty wide ranging. So let me touch on a couple things. I mentioned in my remarks that you need innovation, you need some new ideas. And so if you're looking at the cost of school, which is part of affordability, it's not just how big is your grant, how big is your loan, and what's your interest rate, what does it cost to go to school? And the president, you know, he wants everything free, except not. But what we're seeing is that you have steps being taken. Some of it is online education. We moved three pieces of legislation in the closing days of the last Congress addressing higher ed issues. They were looking to get at that. One of it was so that you could get credit for competencies that you had. So you can take fewer courses and lower the cost of going to school. That passed 416-0. So you can get some bipartisan support. In fact, all three bills, one of them passed by voice vote, and the other one I think had two no votes. I mean, so we've already got, I think, a little bit more than our toe in the water. Now, the Senate didn't take those up, so we'll roll those back into a higher ed reauthorization. But we want to find ways to allow schools to keep their costs down so that your total cost is lower, regardless of whether you're high income, middle income, low income. You need to know what that school costs. And so one of the bills was, we're just trying to provide information. I mentioned in my remarks that parents and students, and by the way, the traditional student, the young man or woman who graduates high school and goes off to college the next year, is now in the minority. More than half of higher ed students are non-traditional, which is now traditional. But so there are lots of driving forces to try to keep costs down, but people need to, they need information to know what those costs are going to be and what their expectations might be. And so we're looking at that in the legislation. And then the whole mess of loans and grants of student aid needs to be simplified. And Senator Alexander and I have talked about that, but there's lots of suggestions, but you've got to get that down. Maybe, you know, one loan, one grant or something, so you get it down simple so people understand. In fact, one of the bills that we passed was a kind of a financial literacy that said you have to be counseled up front on what your obligations are. You can't have people going to 3 or 4 years of college and then they say, oh, I thought that student loan thing was a grant. Oh, what kind of education did you just get? But they need good information, and we just need to simplify some of this stuff. So that's a long answer to the question, but we've got to work at all aspects of it.
Sure.
Hi, Joel Packer with the Raven Group and the Committee for Education Funding. So last Congress, under your leadership, two bipartisan education-related bills were enacted into law, the reauthorization of CCDBG and Workforce Investment Act, and mm-hmm. just mentioned Ezra almost got there. So what were sort of the secrets to that success? Were there lessons from those that are applicable to getting bipartisan agreement on ESEA? And then what role do you see Bobby Scott and the Democrats on your committee playing this year?
Boy, you know, an educated, well-informed audience, that's just not even fair. let me start with Bobby Scott. He is the new ranking member. I've obviously known him for 12 years, served on the committee together. I think it's a matter of established record that his energies have been spent on the Judiciary Committee, but he's been a member of Education Workforce and attended hearings, and he has some definite interests and concerns. He and I will agree on some things we've already talked about and not on others. I mentioned I've been very declarative in saying I like public charter schools. He does not. So we'll have to work through some of those. That's all right. George Miller and I disagreed on a lot of stuff, an awful lot of stuff. But we agreed on some things. And so back to how did you get some stuff done? Well, it was helpful when George and I agreed on something. So on the Workforce Investment Act, we had different ideas about what the language is going to be, but we were able to put together in the committee a bill that we called the Skills Act. It was a great bill. It was just wonderful. I loved it. Eliminated a whole bunch of stovepipe programs and things. Simplified it. Made the boards more flexible and responsive. And George didn't like that bill all that well. I thought it was great. But so how does it get done? So I'll briefly tell that story. But it varies bill by bill by bill. But in this case, I got a call from Senator Johnny Isaacson from Georgia. He had served in that committee, Education and Workforce Committee, when John Boehner was the chairman. And he said, John, he said, is there any chance we can get WEA done? He said, Patty Murray and I really want to get it done. And I said, well, Johnny, I said, you know, we passed a bill in the House and we eliminated 37 programs. You haven't passed a bill in the Senate. You moved one through committee. You eliminated one. And that one hadn't been funded in a decade. So we're pretty far apart here. Yeah, he said, I know, but we really need to. So we went to work. And that's the world the staff went to work. And they really went to work. And they started talking to Democrats in the House and to the senators. And then it got to the point where I had to go to work, you know, so I could talk to my counterpart at the time was Tom Harkin. And he wanted to get it done. And so those were the pieces. We knew we had a mess out there. I had governors just foaming. You got to fix this. This is a terrible system. And so the need to get it fixed was apparent. And we did that by working it out before the Senate passed a bill. And then once we had agreed language, then they brought up the bill and we both passed the bill. They made us change the name to WEOA. You can't trust the Senate to do anything. But it was an important piece of legislation, and we got it done. And so we can use different models. I expect with the ESEA, replacing No Child Left Behind, that it'll be the more conventional. We pass a bill, they pass a bill, and we go to conference. And again, the wind is kind of back in the sails, like it was with WEA. There is a growing now coast to coast, and even off the coast, recognition. You got to change the status quo, and that'll help us get it done.
Mr. Chairman, speaking of staff, they've informed me that they need to get you back to the Hill, leaving by 9:30 for a vote. So
okay.
I want to thank you so much for joining us today and for
happy to be here.
Your forthrightness.
Thanks, Rick. Thank you very much.